गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग. गुड मॉर्निंग.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग. सो हाउ आर यू इन दिस व्हाट यू डिड इन द 3 days हॉलीडे. तो बारिश में क्या होना है. बारिश तो बाहर हो रहा था ना अंशुमान. ओके. सो व्हाई आई हैव आस्क्ड दिस क्वेश्चन बिकॉज आई होप दैट यू मस्ट हैव कम प्रिपेयर्ड विथ द टॉपिक विच वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे. दैट इज द इंडक्टिव रीजनिंग एंड द इंडक्टिव मेथड ऑफ टीचिंग मैथमेटिक्स विच इज हियर इन द पार्ट ऑफ द टीचिंग फॉर प्रूफ. That is our main content to be discussed. Okay. So here we will start with a question that or we will start with what is the proof, so that we will able to link that why should we teach mathematics for the proof and what are the different methods of proof in mathematics. Some of the things we have already discussed in detail in the last year, and some of the thing it is also not very much new for this class, but we will discuss in detail. That discussion was not in detail in the earlier classes. Okay, so can anybody say that what is the proof in mathematics? Because we have, I think, already discussed in the last year also, and we have discussed in the unit 1 also, when we were discussing the unit 1. Can somebody tell what is the mathematical proof?
Sir, correctiveness of the statement.
Correctiveness of the statement.
Yes, sir.
That is not appropriate definition, I think, Asutosh. Little bit modification is required. Yes, it is a process. Yes. Okay. You are very much right, Amya, that it is a process of establishing the truthness of mathematical statement, or we can say that the propositions, because we know that the mathematical statement is a statement which is straightforward, means a declarative, and which is not having any ambiguity. This is the definition of mathematical statement. Whenever we are talking about the statement in mathematics, it is a statement. Which kind of a statement? Which doesn't have any ambiguity. Ambiguity means either it will be true or it will be false. If it is a true, then it will be true in all the cases. If it is a false, then it will be false in all the cases. That is the ambiguity free. Meaning of ambiguity free. And the more important thing is that it must be declarative, means you are declaring something. Like that we declare that under root, or better to say the square root of 9 is 3. So it is a declarative. We are declaring that the square root of 9 is 3. Or declarative may be, it is a, today is Monday. Okay, today is the 5th October. But this statement that I am telling, that today is a Monday or today is a 5th October, is not ambiguity free. It is an ambiguous sentence. Because when we consider a point of reference of the present time, then it is a correct. But the same statement when we'll see, next day or a previous day or after some time, 5 or 6 days, that today is a Monday, today is the 5th October, then this statement won't be valid, means it will become false. So at some moment of a time it is a true, whereas at some moment of a time, it is a false. So that is not ambiguity free. But in mathematics, it is not like that. If it is a declarative unambiguous sentence, so it will be true. Suppose that I told that a square root of 9 is 3. It will be always true. Whether you say it today or tomorrow or after some time or after a long time even, it will be 3 only. That is the ambiguity free meaning of that ambiguity free. Then we have come to know that the mathematical statement, elaborate discussion we had in the previous class, that's why I am not elaborating much what are the structure of mathematical statement. Next come to the proof of mathematics, proof in mathematics. Proof in a mathematics is a process to establish either the truthfulness of the mathematical statement or establishing a falsity of a mathematical statement. Because through that process, either we will establish the truthness or we will establish the falsity. Okay. Suppose that we say that if there is a two parallel line P and Q and one transversal, suppose that L, is cutting those parallel lines at X and Y, then the alternate angle and a correspondence angle will be equal. It is a mathematical statement. But the moment when we will establish the truthness, so it will become a theorem. And when we will establish its falsity, that the alternate angle or the correspondence angle is not equal to each other, then the statement will be termed as a false statement and it will be rejected. That is the proof in mathematics. It is a procedure to establish the truthness or falsity of a mathematical statement. We know that there are various methods, techniques by which we can establish either the truthness or a falsity. What are those? Can somebody reply? What are those methods by which we can establish the truthness or a falsity of a mathematical statement?
Method of contradiction. Contradiction.
Achha. Contradiction, contrapositive.
Method of disproof. Method of disproof.
Method of disproof.
Then induction,
induction,
deduction,
induction,
deduction,
deduction, deduction, deduction. Then see, we have already discussed that when we talk about the different types that we use in a mathematics to prove the truthness or a falsity, one is based on the approach. That is the inductive and deductive that we will be seeing here. Another is also based on the approach, that is the analysis and synthesis, that we will be also discussing in this unit. Earlier we have seen the procedure, that how we proceed, and based upon the procedures there are two broad categories. One is the direct proof, another one is the indirect proof. And the reply you have given, like contrapositive, contradiction, disproof, or we also say that disproof as a counterexample, is it comes under the indirect proof. So that part we will leave, and today we will discuss about the induction, and in the next class or in the coming class we will discuss the deduction and the analysis and synthesis as well. So, can anybody say that what is the induction? Because a little bit idea we had already about the induction also. Anybody?
Sir, induction means general to specific.
जनरल टू स्पेसिफिक, ओके, आर स्पेसिफिक टू जनरल,
एग्जाम्पल टू
की जनरल,
एग्जाम्पल टू
की जनरल,
एग्जाम्पल टू
रूल, रूल,
हाँ वन बाय वन यू टेल, जस्ट हु विल टेल फर्स्ट, बिकॉज ना मल्टीपल वाइस इफ कम्स इट इज नॉट कम्प्रहेंसेबल, ओके विभू यू टेल फर्स्ट दैट वेदर इट इज अ जनरल टू अ स्पेसिफिक और अ स्पेसिफिक टू जनरल. No, you don't want to say, Vivu. I think I have got one response in the chat also.
General to
specific. Okay, and that Rosaline is saying example to rule. Anuja Misra is saying specific to general for the induction. So it is now confusion that whether it is a general to a specific or a specific to general. Isn't it? So see, when we talk about the induction, what we used to do in the induction is that we take examples like that. I will continue with the example that I was mentioning earlier, that suppose that there is a two parallel lines, suppose that L and M, and it is cut by a transversal, suppose that L M and then P. So L and M is a parallel line, P is a transversal which is cutting both the parallel lines. Then two type of angle will be formed, that is the one is the alternate angle and one is the correspondence angle. Suppose that for sake of example I am taking the correspondence angle, okay. So one example I have taken and we have measured what is the measure of correspondence angles and we found that it is the same. Then again example we have taken, then again we have measured what is the measure of a correspondence angle, then find that it is again same. And likewise a number of examples we have taken and we found that in each the case correspondence angle is same. So what now we can conclude that if two lines are parallel and it is being cut by a transversal, so the correspondence angle thus formed will have a equal measure. So what we have did, we have taken one particular example, a specific example, particular example, a specific example, then again example, then again example, then again example, and lots of examples, and we have concluded. Conclusion is the generalization. Now we have made a statement that if two lines are a parallel, if it is a being cut by a transversal, then thus formed correspondence angle will have a equal measure. So now we are generalizing and we are making a rule, we are making a formula. So again when the case will come, suppose that again I am getting a situation where the two parallel lines are there and the parallel lines are cut by the transversal. So again it is not required to measure the angle correspondence angle. We can say that it will have a equal measure. Why? Because we have seen a number of examples and on the basis of a number of example we came to know that it will have a equal measure. So now when the situation will come, we will directly use a rule because it become a rule now. It become a generalization now. It become a formula now. So induction always moves from example to generalization. A specific case to generalization. Example to formula. concrete to abstract. So whenever we are talking about the induction, basically when we talk about the induction, it is a process of establishing a truthness of a mathematical statement or a falsity of a mathematical statement by the empirical validation of the statement. We are empirically validating, means we are seeing a actual example, and by the observation of a example we are coming to a conclusion. That is the induction method. Okay, and when we talk about the induction, it's a philosophical base. I think the slide is now visible to your screen. Actually, its base is traced with the philosophical orientation and a foundation of a epistemology, because the epistemology have emphasized that the focus of a teaching should follow from the example to the rule. Concretization is a citation of a lot of example where the mathematical statement holds good, it is a valid. And the philosophical foundation of this method you can find with the epistemology, who was in opinion that teaching must follow from example to the rule. Specifically, when we are teaching at a school level, because in the school level students are developing the concepts, students are understanding that how the different mathematical formula can be visualized and it operates. So in order to visualization, we must go from the example to the formula. I think in some moment of a time I have also mentioned that in the lower classes, I think now it is visible, or still it is not visible?
Yes sir.
It is visible now, na? So I think at some moment of a time I have taught you that in the lower classes we used to proceed from the example to the formula, whereas in the higher classes we used to proceed for the, this is the higher classes, this is the lower classes. Okay, so in the lower classes we proceeded from the example to the formula, whereas in the higher classes we proceed from the formula to example or formula to the problem, how to solve it. Because in the lower classes students are conceptualizing the concept, they are understanding, they are building the concept that how this concept operates, how that formula comes. Like that in the lower classes when you will tell the student that area of a circle or a circular disc, what is the area, is pi r square, or a circumference of a circle is pi 2 pi r, or a volume of the cylinder is pi r square h, then they may wonder that how these formulas are coming, why this area is pi r square, or why the volume is pi r square h, or why the circumference is 2 pi r. Okay, so they may wonder and they may not understand if we will not exemplify that how these formulas are coming. Or even for very specific, if I say that this is the rectangle and this is the b and this is the l, so the perimeter will be 2 into b plus l, this will be the perimeter. So they may wonder that how this 2 into b plus l will come. They may also wonder that if there is a perimeter, and if we think about the area, that how this b and l will come. This is the area. So they may wonder and they may not understand, because the process is not shown to them, because it is not exemplified to them. So they will feel it difficult to understand. That's why in the lower grade we used to proceed from the example to the formula, whereas in the higher classes, first thing behind proceeding from formula to example, that some of the basic concept they have understood now, that this is the formula for calculating the circumference, this is the formula for calculating the volume of a cylinder and how it comes. So now they will directly use in examples, now directly they will use in a specific case to solve the problem. So that's why we use the formula in a higher formula to example or a specific case in the higher classes, whereas the specific case or exam from example to formula in the lower classes. This is the reason why we used to do. Okay. So that was that, and now come to the other part of induction and deduction method. So in the induction, we proceed from the concrete to abstract, and we proceed from the examples to the particular rule or a formula or a generalized result. So that is the method of a inductive method. For more example, you may see that I have given the same example here also, that I was talking about the there are two parallel lines here, in the two parallel lines are AB and CD, and it is being cut by a transversal EF, and it is cutting on the point P and Q. So the alternate angle and the correspondence angle. Okay, suppose that the correspondence angle here is a APF, and this is the correspondence angle CQF. So these two angle will be equal. Similarly, FPB will be equal, FQD will be equal in each the cases, and the other set of correspondence angles also. But here you must remember that So here in this case, we are basically relying on the examples given, and by the example we are thinking that the student will frame the concept, they will understand the concept, they will conceptualize it. So that's why we are required as a teacher to present a multiple number of example, and there should be a variety in examples also, because when you will see the majority of a textbook, or when the teachers are teaching in the majority of the cases, they draw the parallel line horizontally, like that in the example 2, here this example. Are you able to see the examples? So teacher used to draw the horizontal parallel lines, and then there is a slanting line which is cutting the horizontal parallel lines. So when you will draw all the cases like that, then the student will find that the parallel lines are only horizontal, and the transversal line is always a slanting. So if a different type of a situation will be coming, like that the example 3, this is the example 3. Okay, so they will understand that in this case, AB and CD is not a parallel because it is not a horizontal. Why? Because it is a differing from the examples that they have seen a lot of a time and they have concluded. So, a number of a cases in a varieties must be presented to the student. Because they are framing the concept based upon the examples you are citing here. Okay, so that is the one of the precaution we must take. The second example is of this triangles. Suppose that we used to teach about them that what are the sum of internal angle of a triangle. Then in each of the case they will measure the internal angle and then they will find that in each of the cases sum of internal angle is 180 degree and then they will conceptualize. One again I will tell you that whenever you are presenting a lot of a triangle for conceptualizing them that sum of internal angle of a triangle is 180 degree, then you must present a variety in the shape, size and a type. Like that several time I have also mentioned that whenever we draw a right angle triangle, for sake of example, this one is the right angle triangle, the first triangle is the right one, right angle triangle. Okay, so here the base is horizontal line, the perpendicular is the vertical line and the hypotenuse is the slanting line. And generally, usually we used to draw a triangle, right angle triangle in that fashion only. And if we are drawing a triangle in that fashion only, so they will understand that the right angle triangle is this type only. But here you find that this triangle. Okay, first, second, third, fourth one. Okay, the rightmost triangle. It is also a right angle triangle, but the orientation is and a shape is shape and size is a different, but it is a right angle triangle. So, a variety of a triangle must be presented and then they must be given opportunity by themselves. It is not like that you will measure and tell them, see it is a right 180 degree. No, let they get opportunity to measure it. In another case, this is also that two lines are cutting each other. Okay, so here what will be the measure of the opposite angles, what will be the measure of each angle and what are the correlation? You don't tell that what are the correlation. You just give them a figure, lot of a figure and tell them find out what is the common property in each cases. Because here in the induction we are searching for the common property the figures are having and that common property needs to be generalized, that is the inductive process. So you don't tell that what are the common property you are finding, you just tell them measure each angle. Here the angle will be AOC, COB, BOD, DOC, DOA. Then again will be that what is the relation between this and this, this and this, like that. You tell them to find out so that they will find out the relation and then they will tell you, sir, this is the relation I am finding here. And that is the method of teaching with a inductive method. You don't tell. For sake of example, here also you can find that I have taken 5 number of figures. Okay, 5 number of figures I have taken. So you tell them that what is the internal angle, sum of internal angle, total internal angle in each cases. What is the sum of internal angle in a triangle? What is the sum of internal angle in this square? I have made it a square. What is the sum of internal angle in the trapezium? What is the sum of internal angle in the pentagon? What is the sum of internal angle in the hexagon? then they will say it is 180 degree, it is 360 degree, it is 360 degree, it is 540 degree, like that. They will measure and they will tell. Then you tell them that is there is a some sequence in that? Is there is a some sequence? So they will tell, sir, this is the 180 degree. This figure can be divided in two triangles. And this is a 360 degree. So it will become 1 minute. So it will become like that, it is a 180 degree. It will become a 360 degree. It will become again 360 degree. It will become 540 degree. It is 5. It is a 540 degree. Okay, like that. And then I will tell, sir, then what is the correlation? What are the specific pattern you are finding? So the specific pattern is that triangle is a triangle and its measure is 180 degree. A square can be divided into two triangle, and this 180 360 degree will become 2 into 180. This is 1 into 180 degree. This is again 2 into 180 degree. This is 3 into 180 degree. This is 4 into 180 degree.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
One thing I find out.
स्क्वायर में तो और भी ट्रायंगल बन सकते हैं, वैसे भी पेंटागन में भी और भी ट्रायंगल बन सकते हैं, तो
पेंटागन में भी और भी ट्रायंगल बन सकते हैं.
ओके ओके, आई अंडरस्टूड योर क्वेश्चन. ओके, आई अंडरस्टूड, आई गॉट योर क्वेश्चन दैट इवन द नंबर ऑफ अ ट्रायंगल इज पॉसिबल. आई विल टेक केयर ऑफ दैट. जस्ट फिनिश मी दिस व्हाट आई एम डिस्कसिंग, देन आई विल कम टू योर क्वेश्चन. आई गॉट योर क्वेश्चन. ओके, so just let me finish, then I am coming to your question. So we can find that it is a 1 into 180 degree, sorry, 0 was missing, 180 degree. This is 2 into 180 degree, 3 into 180 degree, sorry, 2 into 180 degree, 3 into 180 degree, and 4 into 180 degree. But suppose that I have a polygon with 50 sides. So again it is impossible to divide into in a triangle and the count the triangle. Here it was a quite limited number, so it is a triangle. I have counted, I have divided, I have counted in the square. Even in this trapezium, I have divided and I counted. Pentagon divided, counted, and hexagon divided and counted. Suppose that it is of a 50 sides, so again it will be difficult. So again this generalization is not going to help me. But again we will come to a next level of a generalization. That here number of side is a 3, so we are multiplying with 1 into 180 degree. So it means that a number of a side, here it was 3, so 3 minus 2 it come 1. Here also number of a side was 4 and I am multiplying with 2, so 4 minus 2. Here also 4 minus 2. Here it was 5 and I was multiplying with the 3, so 5 minus 2. Here it was 6, I am multiplying with the 4, so it is 6 minus 2. So what I am getting, that number of a side of a polygon minus 2 and it is multiplied by the 180 degree. In each of the case you can extend this also up to 10 sides octagon or like that. You will find this same sequence will follow. So now what I have concluded, that in order to find out the sum of internal angle of any polygon, we have to count the number of a side. Suppose that a number of a side in a polygon that I am taking is 50. It will be subtracted by the 2 into multiplied by the 180 degree. So it will become 48 multiplied by the 180 degree. So by that I have generalized by observing a particular cases. Okay. But here always remember, you must give opportunity to do the student by themselves. You provide the opportunity, you provide the cases, and a lot of variety in the cases must be given, because here they are generalizing by themselves. Okay, now I am, yes, I think Asis was asking the question. Am I right?
Yes.
So, I will come to your question that variety of a triangle, drawing a triangle is possible. So, why I am drawing only two triangles? See, the first thing is that while I am framing the triangle, you can say that one possibility of drawing a triangle is this, like that I have drawn. You may tell that, sir, no, I will not draw by this, I will draw like that. It is also correct. Someone will say, no, suppose that this is A, B, C, D. So, I will not only connect B and D, I will also connect A and C. So, now I have a triangle 1, 2, 3, 4. Four triangles are there. Some will tell, no, sir, I will also draw like that. So, now the triangle will, number of a triangle will increase. Someone will say that I will also draw like that. So, number of triangle will increase. Then, I must say, while we see, here our motto is not to draw a triangle, how many triangles are possible, as much as triangle is possible. Our motto is to find some sequence, some common thing by which we can come to a generalized formula of calculating the sum of internal angle of a polygon. This is our motto. ठीक है? So, first thing is that here we will not try that how many triangle we can frame. Here our motto will be that how we can find a sequence, how we can find a common thing in all the cases, and we can generalize and we can come to a formula. So, first thing is that we will try to connect from one vertex of a polygon to the other vertex of a polygon. Like that, in here, this is the one vertex B and the another one is a C, D and A. Or three others are there. So, when we will connect B to C, nothing will happen. C to D, nothing will happen. D to A, like that, nothing will happen. So, what will happen? Something, we can divide the figure if we will connect B to D. If you are interested, you can connect A to C also. Connecting A to C or connecting B to D is equal. But here our motto will be connect the vertex so that we can find, what is that? Sum of internal angle of a triangle is already known to us that it is a 180 degree. So, we will reduce the other figures also by in a such a way that it will become a combination of a triangle. See, so if we will connect B and D or A and C, then this figure will become a combination of two triangles. And here also our motto is that suppose that I am interested to calculate the internal angle. So, we have to measure this, we have to measure this, we have to measure this, and we have to measure this. So, if we will connect the vertex, so this is the one triangle we will get, that BCD, and then another triangle we will get ABD. Okay, so here this and this angle are counted, because both the triangle, when we will see together, this angle will be also counted, this angle will be also counted, and this angle will be also counted. So here we are reducing to a simpler figure whose sum of internal angle is known. Our motto is not to frame as much triangle can be formed by dividing the polygon. So that's why we are connecting the vertex. Here also we have connected the vertex. Here also, suppose that this is the A, B, C, D, and E. Let's take the any point, suppose that I am taking A, or let us take E also. So if we will connect this, nothing will happen. What we can do? We can connect this, so it will frame one triangle. We will connect this, so it will frame another triangle, and the third one will be obvious. So it is a simplified in a combination of a triangle. Here also, see, it is a simplified in a combination of a triangle, that is a four combination of a triangle, so that it can be simplified, and simplified in a such a way that is already known to us. The sum of internal angle of a triangle is already known to us, because the sum of internal angle of a polygon is in the higher hierarchy of a concept than sum of a internal angle of a triangle. First we used to teach them about the triangle, then we are moving towards the polygons. Okay, so our motto is that. That's why we are not framing like that this and this type of triangle, or that lot of a triangle, or here also this type of a triangle. As a B we can also do, Anna. So many things are possible. Even if we connect by this, it will be like that. So many things are possible, but we are simplifying. Our motto is to simplify. Our motto is not to calculate that how many triangle can be framed. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that is our motto. Is it clear to you, Asis?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think we should stop this class here. If you have any other question, you can also ask here, and then we will stop this class. And in the next class, we will see the other aspect of an inductive method. Okay. Is there any question?
No, sir.
From this inductive method?
No, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, shall we stop this class here?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. So, thank you for being with me in this class. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.